Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I request the dignitaries to please come onto the dais and take their seats, please. Program ka aagaz khiraat se kiya jayega. To main yahan par aawaz deti hu hamare talib-e-ilm Asadur Rahman ko khiraat kalam ko pesh kare.
Introduction of Surah. The Surah begins by describing how on the day of judgment the earth will give off a terrible earthquake and throw up her burden. Through the inspiration of God, the earth will bear witness to the actions of men it has witnessed. Human beings will then realize that the moment of accountability has arrived. The miraculous accountability will reflect good and evil deeds that might have seemed insignificant at that time. The two concluding verses state that all men will be sorted out into groups according to their deeds, and they will see the consequence of everything they have done, every action, weight of good or evil. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. I seek refuge with Allah from the accursed Shaitan. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. Iza zulzilatil ardu zilzalaha wa ahrajatil ardu athqalaha wa qala al insanu ma laha yawma idhin تحدث أحبارها بأن ربك أوحى لها يومئذ تحدث أحبارها بأن ربك أوحى لها يومئذ يصدر الناس أشتاتا ليروا أعمالهم فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ.
Translation.
When the earth is shaken with its final earthquake, and the earth discharges its burden, and man says, "What is wrong with it?" That day it will report its news, because your Lord has inspired it. That day the people will depart separated into groups to be shown the result of their deeds. And whoever does an atom's weight of good will see it, and whoever does an atom weight of evil will see it. Sadaqallahul Azim. Jazakumullah.
Welcome our guest here, our registrar sahab, Dr. M. A. Sikandar. The chief guest of today's function, Dr. Mohan Kanda, former chief secretary AP. And our guest of honor, Dr. V. S. Prasad sahab, director of the seminar. Professor Rahmatullah, Dean Satellite Campuses, Professor Shahida Ma'am, Dean School of Arts and Social Sciences, Deans, HODs, colleagues, delegates, media, good morning to one and all. Is do roza khomi seminar mein aap sabhi ka khair maqdam hai. I welcome you all for this National Seminar on Disaster Management in India being organized by the Department of Public Administration, MANUU. The theme of the seminar has been decided after a lot of deliberations, keeping in mind its relevance to the present times. Aafat ka intezamiya, that is disaster management. Aaj samaj mein, chahe wo तरक्की याफ्ता मुल्क हो या तरक्की पज़ीर मुल्क हो, आफात कहीं भी हो सकती है या आफात कहीं भी पाई जा सकती है. सकती है कोई ऐसा समाज नहीं है जो डिज़ास्टर या आफात से बचा हुआ नहीं है और शायद आज समाज या इंसानियत की ज़िंदगी का हिस्सा बन चुका है आफात का इंतज़ामिया और इस मौजू से जो सेमिनार किया रखा गया है यहाँ पर इस मौजू के बारे में काफ़ी तहकीक की जा रही है न सिर्फ बैनुल अक़वामी सतह पर बल्कि कौमी सतह पर भी क्योंकि जिस तरह की आफात वो लाता है चाहे वो कुदरती तौर पर हो या फिर इंसानों के ज़रिए बनाई गई हो जान माल का नुकसान इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर का नुकसान और महीशत का नुकसान देखा जाता है तो आफात का इंतज़ामिया और उसका मकसद ये होता है कि उस डिज़ास्टर को या उस आफात को किस तरह से उसकी रोकथाम करनी चाहिए उस पर कंट्रोल करना चाहिए ताकि हम उसके असर को या फिर उसके मनफी असरात को कम से कम करें और उसकी रोकथाम करें या फिर पहले से ही उसकी पेशखयासी करें और पूरी तरह से हम तैयार रहें किसी भी किस्म के डिज़ास्टर या आफात का सामना करने के लिए डिज़ास्टर्स आर अ कॉमन फिनोमिनन अकरिंग इन ऑलमोस्ट ऑल कंट्रीज वेदर डेवलप्ड और डेवलपिंग डेवलपिंग कंट्रीज आर द मोस्ट अफेक्टेड वंस विच सफर फ्रॉम डिज़ास्टर्स डिज़ास्टर मैनेजमेंट has become a subject of vital importance today, not only at the international level, but at the national level also. A lot of research is now being carried out to study and analyze disasters and to effectively manage them, to prevent them as much as possible. In modern times, the approach has changed from providing relief and rehabilitation to a more holistic and proactive approach of not only forecasting and controlling, but equally focusing on its mitigation, prevention. With the advancement of science and technology, it has become easier to predict and assess disasters to a certain extent, take cognizance of the entire eventuality, and minimize the damage that is likely to be caused. इस प्रोग्राम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए मैं प्रोग्राम के डायरेक्टर प्रोफेसर रहमतुल्ला साहब को यहाँ पर उनसे गुजारिश करती हूँ कि वो आए और सेमिनार के बारे में एड्रेस करें
Good morning to all of you. President of this inaugural session, Professor V.S. Prasad Sahab, my guru. Chief guest of this inaugural function, Dr. Mohan Kanda Sahab, former Chief Secretary, Government of Andhra Pradesh. Dr. M.S. Sikandar Sahab, guest of honor of this inaugural function. Moses Hazrin, Sabko Adab, I welcome all of you. First of all, let me say a word that our Honorable Vice Chancellor is very busy in some urgency. That's why he could not attend this inaugural session. We requested our guru, Dr. V.S. Prasad, to chair this session, and he readily accepted in the place of Honorable Vice Chancellor. And we are blessed in this regard. So also, I approached our Registrar, Dr. M.S. Sikandar Sahab, and requested him to be the guest of honor in the place of Dr. V.S. Prasad Sahab. He has also readily accepted our invitation, and we are very much thankful to him also. So well, friends, coming to the topic, I am here before you to give a brief introduction of this 2 days national seminar on disaster management in the backdrop of disaster management in India. Let me present the significance of disasters management in India and the backdrop, keeping in view of that only, we have decided to go ahead with this topic. As you know, disasters have always been a subject of great concern in the learners and scholars all over the world. According to the International Disaster Database, disasters have been hitting the world continuously, increased steadily since 1960, and the hardest hit are only the developing countries, and resulted in life, property, and environmental loss to the great extent. India is no exception to it. Indian subcontinent has been one of the most disaster-prone zones in the world. It has had some of the world's most severe disasters. The need of the hour is therefore to chalk out a multi-pronged strategy for total disaster management to reduce the toll of disasters. Disaster, what does it mean? Disaster as a concept is used, studied, and researched by people from a multitude of disciplines, starting from environmental science to psychology, and from geological science to public policy. That's why the development of a precise definition of disaster has not been an easy task. However, a disaster can be defined as an extremely disruption of the functioning of society that causes human, material, and environmental losses that are beyond the ability of the affected people to cope with their own resources. The term disaster has been derived from the Greek culture, which refers to a bad star. Thus, the root of the word disaster comes from the astrological theme in which the ancients used to refer to destruction or deconstruction of a star as a disaster. In simple words, disaster has come to be known as a tragedy which badly affects society in all respects. Next, I am going to present a brief theoretical insight into the disaster. If we look into the theoretical framework of disaster, we may find the following general four theories. And the essence of these theories are as follows. Number one, theory of act of God. It says that disasters are the divine retribution of human wrongdoings. Number two, theory of act of nature. It is about science and says that disasters are the result of functioning of nature in the geophysical world. Number three, theory of joint effects of nature and society. It says that disasters will happen due to the deliberate and non-deliberate human interventions into the functioning of nature. Fourth, and the last theory that is available on disaster, theory of social construction. It says that disasters happen depending upon how the society is constructed, both in the physical and social aspects. Next, coming to other aspect, that is types of disasters. Disasters have been broadly classified into two categories, namely natural and human made disasters, floods, droughts, earthquakes, volcanoes, cyclones, tsunamis are generally considered natural disasters. However, it should not be forgotten that there is possibility that certain human actions in short or long term may also play a contributory role for the occurrence of natural disasters. Coming to the second type of disasters, it can be said that these are primarily caused due to certain human factors or failures, and this may happen because of unintentional or intentional activities of human beings. Nuclear leaks, chemical leaks, industrial and transport accidents, environmental pollution, and terrorist activities are generally regarded as man-made disasters. Coming to the other aspect of disasters, that is, disaster risk in India. India is vulnerable in varying degrees to a large number of natural disasters on account of its unique geoclimatic conditions, and it is vulnerable to man-made disasters too. About 60% of the land mass is prone to earthquake to various intensities. Over 12% land is prone to floods. About 8% of the total area is prone to cyclones, and 68% of the area is susceptible to the drought. In the decade 1919-2000, an average of about 4,344 people lost their lives, and about 30 million people were affected by disaster every year. Almost all parts of India experience one or more of these events. India has witnessed a large number of man-made disasters too. There have been many terrorist activities, technological, industrial, and transportation disasters in India. The Bhopal gas tragedy is the world's biggest industrial disaster to date. Disasters result in loss of not only human, animal, and all lives on earth, but also involve destruction of property and infrastructure, cause injuries, spread diseases, replace social and cultural life, and destroy ecology. On account of disasters, the loss in terms of private, community, and public assets has been astronomical. The next aspect of disaster management, that is, disaster management in India, coming to the theme. Indian Constitution, the Magna Carta of Fundamental Rights for Indians, guarantees protection of life and security with the purpose of ensuring a welfare state. India has been following 5-year plans to ensure welfare states, but the earlier 5-year plans did not mention about disaster management. However, since 10th 5-year plan, more particularly since 11th 5-year plan, the disaster management has emerged as a high priority for the country, and India has enacted Disaster Management Act 2005. The Act lays down institutional, legal, financial, and coordination mechanisms at the national, state, and local levels. As a result of it, National Disaster Management Authority at the national level, with Prime Minister as the chairman, state disaster management authorities at the state level, with respective chief ministers as chairman, and district disaster management authorities at the district level, headed by respective district collectors, have been established. These institutions are not parallel structures and will work in close harmony. The new institutional framework is expected to ensure paradigm shift in disaster management from relief-centric approach to proactive regime that lays greater emphasis on preparedness, prevention, and mitigation towards disaster management in India. Further, the Government of India has set up a National Center for Disaster Management at Indian Institute of Public Administration, New Delhi, and later upgraded it into National Institute of Disaster Management, and it is functioning as an institute for the human resource development in the area of disaster management. However, a number of acts, institutions, and forces like the Environment Protection Act 1986, the Coastal Regulation Zone Notification 1991, the Public Liability Insurance Act 1991, National Disaster Response Force, etc., have been enacted and formed. Above all, in the academic year 2003 and 4, Central Board of Secondary Education India took a pioneering step of starting disaster management education as a part of social sciences in class 8. In the subsequent academic year 2004 and 5, disaster management was added to class 9. In the following academic year, disaster management was progressively added to class 11th and 12th. Later, UGC has issued a letter to introduce it in higher education. The Department of Public Administration, MANUU Hyderabad, has taken an initiative to introduce a paper on disaster management in public administration at the UG and PG level programs. Thus, disaster management has emerged as a high priority for the country, and nation needs to be sensitive towards disaster prevention, preparedness, and mitigation. As such, in order to create awareness among the people regarding disaster management and have a comprehensive discussion on it, this 2 days national seminar is intended by the Department of Public Administration, MANUU Hyderabad. Last aspect of this seminar, coming to objectives of the seminar, let me spell out. The National Seminar on Disaster Management is being organized with the following objectives: to deepen participants' theoretical and practical knowledge of issues involved in disaster management, to identify different kinds of disasters and their consequences, to analyze major disaster issues and potential crises, to discuss existing laws, policy framework, and institutions of disaster management and suggest measures for their improvement, to familiarize participants with tools and methods of disaster management in order to enable them to cope with disasters. Finally, friends, let me say, it is hoped and believed that this seminar will certainly be helpful in evolving a right perspective that will be proactive rather than reactive in order to overcome the natural as well as man-made disasters in our beloved country, India. तो ये रहा मुख्तसर तौर पर इस सेमिनार का जो पस मंज़र है और इसके मकासिद हैं उससे मुताल्लुक। आखिर में मैं एक बार फिर वीएस प्रसाद साहब का तह दिल से शुक्रिया अदा करते हुए कि उन्होंने आखिरी लम्हे में जो तब्दीली वाक़ हुई है उसके लिए रजामंदी का इजहार किया, उसी तरह हमारे रजिस्ट्रार साहब का तह दिल से शुक्रिया अदा करते हुए, यकीन मानिए 10 मिनट पहले इस बात से वो वाकिफ भी नहीं थे। جب میں ان کے پاس پہنچا اور ان سے درخواست کی تو میں سمجھتا ہوں کہ بغیر کسی سوچ کے بغیر کسی دوسری تھنکنگ کے انہوں نے کہا یس چلیے رحمت صاحب میں آ رہا ہوں تو اس کے لیے میں ان کا بے دل میں نے تہ دل سے شکریہ ادا کرتے ہوئے اس وعدے کے ساتھ کہ ہمیشہ ہم شکر گزار رہیں گے اور پھر موہن کندا صاحب ظاہر ایک بہت بڑی ہستی جب ہم ڈسکس کر رہے تھے کہ آخر کس کو بلائیں ہم اس انیگورل سیشن کے لیے تو اس سے متعلق مشورے ہمارے رجسٹرار صاحب سے بھی رہے پی وی سی صاحب سے بھی رہے اور آخر کار ہم نے یہ سوچا کہ بھائی ریاستی حکومت میں جو شخص چیف سیکرٹری کے عہدے پر فائز رہا ہو اس سے بہتر ڈیزاسٹر مینجمنٹ کے لیے اور کون ہو سکتا ہے تو اس بات کو ملحوظ رکھتے ہوئے ہم نے ان سے اپروچ کیا ٹیلی فون پہ بات رہی ایک دو مرتبہ میں نے بھی بات کی اور پھر ہمارے ایچ او ڈی صاحبہ ڈاکٹر کنیز زہرا نے بھی ان سے درخواست کی اور انہوں نے بھی ہماری درخواست کو قبول کرتے ہوئے نہ صرف حاضری دینے کا وعدہ کیا بلکہ کی نوٹ ایڈریس بھی دینے کے لیے وہ راضی ہو گئے اور انہوں نے اس کو میل بھی کیا ہے تو اس کے لیے میں ان کا بھی بے حد شکریہ ادا کرتے ہوئے اور اس سیمینار کے ڈائریکٹر کی حیثیت سے ہمارے ڈین صاحبہ فرقان احمد صاحب اور مختلف یونیورسٹیز سے تشریف فرما جو مخالہ نگار ہیں جو ریسرچ اسکالرس ہیں فیکلٹی ممبرس ہیں اور پھر خود ہمارے اپنے ڈپارٹمنٹ کے ریسرچ اسکالرس اور مختلف فیکلٹی ممبرس کا تہ دل سے ایک بار پھر شکریہ ادا کرتے ہوئے اور ان سب کو ویلکم کرتے ہوئے میں اپنی بات کو ختم کرتا ہوں خدا حافظ
Thank you, sir. I request our guest of honor, Dr. M.A. Sikandar Sahab, our registrar, to give a brief address to address the gathering here.
Very good morning to all of you. Assalamu alaikum. Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. Mohan Kanda Sahab, Professor V.S. Prasad, our my dear friend Professor S.M. Rahmatullah Sahab, Madam Kanis Zahra, and other faculty members and from other universities and our MANUU, dear students. It is an honor for me to be here with, a kind of people assembled here. We never only hearing in the newspapers and news channels. So I am really glad to be here. And I have not come prepared. So I will touch upon certain things about the disaster management because you want to hear from the experts on disaster management rather than a naive person like me. Dr. Mohan Kanda Sahab was the former chairman of National Disaster Management Authority, and he, as a civil servant in Andhra Pradesh, he has handled many portfolios. So you'll be better person to address these natural calamities and other issues, and our preparedness to face such calamities in the future in India. Similarly, Professor V.S. Prasad, in his capacity as a academician. And also a former director of NAC and the former vice chancellor of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. He will also touch upon the academic point of view. One thing I want to highlight is because although we have done created several units, subunit or instrumentalities, still we are lacking behind many countries like China, Korea and Japan, far. So although there is a disaster responsive force also, what do you call, national responsive force, there are some of my colleagues earlier served in that, but there are not, it's also lacking behind because they have taken up 3 battalion from BSF, 3 battalion from CRPF and 2 battalion from CISF and 2 from SSB. This is what I heard. So there is no cohesiveness. They work in isolation. Nevertheless, they have done a good job. They have done an international operation also, won it Nepal and Japan also. This is what I heard. But we have to do a lot of work, and especially we have to do a sustained campaign in the school, among the school students, that is going to help, because we are, later generation, we may not be aware of this thing. And we are not doing enough, because I have a kids, one daughter studying in schools. I never heard that, although they are studied in a very elite schools, I never come across anything about only, asking question and project. Practically we are not doing. So there is, and what I want to highlight the point is, it's not as anybody's response, or National Disaster Management Authority, or own MHA, and imparting training. So every citizen of this country, every institution and the instrumentalities of this government has to involve itself at the grassroots level, starting from the students, so the sustained awareness campaign. So I firmly believe this deliberation will help. Somebody will have to do a research, and so this will slowly this will be highlighted in the society. So I do hope the policy makers will pay sufficient attention, because it is going to affect the every life of the people here, and also because of the environmental degradation and all, it is going to, the nature's fury is going to be more and more in the coming future. I wish all the best for the department to organizing this seminar. And I would love to be here, but because of my official commitment, I have to go, sir. With your permission, I will take, after this, I will take leave, and I will join during lunch or something. So he came, Professor Ramatullah was consulting me. I said that you would take some people. I tried to call one faculty. I said, take somebody from the uniform force also. I hope DIG Sikar Sahai, he is a principal of the Fire Service Training Institute in NISA, National Industrial Security Academy. He will be addressing. So I was a trainee there long back, about 20 years back. So hope to see, I will be missing him. Thank you very much. I wish all the best.
Thank you, sir. We thank you for sparing your valuable time here, sir, to grace our function as a guest of honor. I now request our chief guest of the function and the keynote addressee, Dr. Mohan Kanda Sahab, IAS, former Chief Secretary, Government of Andhra Pradesh, for his keynote address. Sir, please. And here I would like to give a brief note of a brief bio sketch, please, sir, of Mohan Kanda Sahab. Born in Chennai, he's done his MSc Mathematics, PhD, Doctorate in Cooperative Agricultural Credit, an IAS, Andhra Pradesh cadre, and retired as Chief Secretary to the Government of Andhra Pradesh. Formerly, he was a Secretary, Agriculture in Cooperation, Department of Agriculture, Cooperation, Ministry of Agriculture, member of the National Disaster Management Authority, NDMA, with the rank and status of a Union Minister of State, then President of the Hyderabad Cricket Association from 1993 to 98, and a member of the governing body of the Bridge Federation of India, member of the Steering Committee for the Agriculture and Allied Sectors of the Planning Commission for the formulation of the 12th Five-Year Plan, and chairman of the jury constituted by the UNICEF to select the best Telugu TV channel in relation to portrayal of issues concerning the girl child. Member, Board of Supervision, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, that is NABARD, and a visiting professor at the Center for Atmospheric Studies, Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. Member of the first Code Central University of Rajasthan and member of the board of management of the Sri Sai Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, Andhra Pradesh. Currently, adjunct faculty in the Indo-German Center for Sustainability, Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT, Chennai. Member of the governing body of Centurion University of Technology and Management. Then Parlakhimandi, Odisha. Independent Director, IFCO Kisan SEZ, Nellore, Andhra Pradesh. Institutional Ethics Committee, Care Hospital, Hyderabad, Telangana. Then sir is also the author of several publications including The Tinctured Canvas, Concept, Practice and Strategies in Rural Development, Vasundhara, an Anthology of Land Resources in India, Forgiving Earth, The Dynamics of Policy Support Reforms for the Millennium Farmer in the Asia-Pacific Region, and Not by Others' Hands, an anthology of a century of credit cooperatives in India, a tribute to the cooperative movement in the International Year of Cooperation 2012. Then Mohana Makarandam, Telugu, Ethics in Governance, Resolution of Dilemmas with Case Studies, Disaster Management in India, Evolution of Institutional Arrangements and Operational Strategies, Trekking Over Pebbles, Life Through a Hyderabadi's Looking Glass. We are honored to have you here, sir, as a chief guest. So, I now request you to deliver your keynote address, sir. Yes.
शुरू में यही कहना चाहता हूँ कि मैं चीफ सेक्रेटरी जरूर रहा आंध्र प्रदेश का, लेकिन my tenure in NDMA, the National Disaster Management Authority, I think is much more relevant. I know. All governments are disasters, so Chief Secretary is also preside over many disasters. But this is a slightly different kind of experience. Or in the beginning, I wish to tell you a small story because it is relevant to what happened today. मैं जरा देर से पहुंचा आज. कल किसी और function में गया था in Gokarajo Engineering College near Sanatnagar. वहाँ पे बड़ी जल्दी पहुंच गया. तो people were not ready to receive me. सब तैयार नहीं थे, यू नो दे डिडंट नो व्हाट टू डू विद मी एंड ऑल दैट. सो थोड़ी देर के बाद सो आई रिमाइंडेड ऑफ अ स्टोरी वेयर अ वीआईपी वेंट टू अ विलेज एंड लाइक मी यस्टरडे वेंट टू अर्ली. सो पीपल वर कंफ्यूज्ड बट देन दे सेटल्ड डाउन एंड देन दे वेंट थ्रू एवरीथिंग फॉर अ कपल ऑफ डेज. ही फिनिश्ड हिज कमिटमेंट्स एंड व्हाइल ही वाज गोइंग अवे बाय वे ऑफ वो मतलब अलविदा के तौर से एक फंक्शन अरेंज करे वो लोग. And then while speaking, a farewell address, the mayor, I believe, of the village said that, sir, we were very sorry that we could not receive you properly, but we are very happy to see you off now, which is not what he meant, but it came that way. What he meant to say was, we are happy that this function is going off well. So I don't want to take too much time because Professor Rahmatullah Sahab has actually delivered, as Mr. Prasad put it, a mini keynote address. He is a learned person. He is a professor. I am only a ordinary Philistine who happened to pass through this subject for a short while. So I'll try and make it as pointed and this thing. Can we have the presentation on, please? Now, shuru mein, I'd like to share another small incident with you which happened in British Parliament. Disraeli was the Prime Minister of Britain and Edmund Burke was the leader of the opposition, if I remember right. Like, just like in NDMA, when all of us took over, General Vij was our vice chairman, Dr. Manmohan Singh was our chairman, 8 others were there. One was former director of Bhabha Atomic Research Center, 2 were retired police officers, one was Shashidhar Reddy, a former minister, and 2 were former IAS officers, and 1 was a professor of disaster management like you. So people from different backgrounds, we were all trying to discuss, behas is baat ki ho rahi thi ki bhai, isko kya bulaya jaye, what do we call it? Do we call it emergency? Do we call it disaster? Do we call it catastrophe? Then finally we used the word disaster management. But in British Parliament, a similar thing was happening. The difference between calamity and catastrophe was being debated. So I believe Burke got up and told the Prime Minister that, sir, if you, agar aap doob jaye, if somebody saves you, if you drown, it will be a calamity. But if somebody saves you, it will be a catastrophe for the nation. So, but anyway, that I just wanted to share that because I told them this to the same story, but ultimately we settled down and we did this. And this is not necessary now. Next slide. Yes, this is one formula which I have personally sort of developed, which is not really an accepted scientific thing. You see, different parts of the world are exposed to different risks of disaster. Coastal area of Andhra Pradesh, you can have cyclones. And Anantapur and Mehboob Nagar, or in Rajasthan or parts of Kutch, you can have droughts. And floods are common in Assam, West Bengal, UP, Eastern UP, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, etc. So, but the same risk does not mean the same vulnerability, because exposure is also required. If a, you know, earthquake takes place in Rajasthan, in the desert, in the run of Kutch, we won't lose anything. But even if a small flood takes place in Hyderabad city, we may lose a lot of property and lives. So, exposure is in terms of the risk to which property and lives are, you know, put. So, risk into exposure, and the more you prepare, the less the impact of the disaster is, naturally. So, risk into exposure divided by preparedness, that is the net vulnerability of an area. So, getting hold of the vulnerability of a nation, a state, or a village, or a town, or Hyderabad city, for instance, what are the disasters, what is the exposure, what is the risk, and then starting, that is the best way of starting the disaster management process. And I am sorry to have to tell you that even 13 years after the disaster management authority has been constituted, till today, we have not done this in our country. There is no assessment of the vulnerability to which India is subjected till today. And even for North Block, Rashtrapati Bhavan, Prime Minister's House, there is no, you know, such plan. But even for the city of Delhi, there is no authoritative report available about what disasters it is vulnerable to, and therefore what steps have to be taken. This is one thing I want to tell you in the beginning. Then, next one please. This shows how globally, over the last 20 years and more, the frequency and the vulnerability, the intensity of disasters has been increasing. Next one, please. Yeah, this is the same thing. Deaths and, you know, loss in billions of dollars, etc. Next one. Now, this map is also shows where the disasters have occurred and when. Next one. So, what should we do? We should reduce the risk. We should mainstream risk reduction into the development programs, and then also have mechanisms which can predict what will happen. Next one. Now, this also shows the increase. Next one. Next one. Next one. Next one. Next one. Ah, no, previous one. Previous one, please. Yeah. The World Bank made a study some time ago when this conference was going on in Davos, and on the sides they made it, and they said that every country annually loses between 2 to 12% of its GDP because of natural disasters. That means, jo hum tarakki hasil kar rahe hain, usko bhi mehfooz nahi rakh pa rahe. What is the point in developing if you are not able to preserve what you have achieved? So, it's a negative thing, because like in cricket they say, a run saved is a run made. Kam se kam isko rukawat ke taur se agar kuch kar sake hum, to at least we'll be saving so much loss for the country. Next one. This is how many people are affected. So, next one. This is an interesting map. Isse zara gaur se dekhiye. See, the same world map, the upper half shows the incidence of disasters, where disasters are taking place. You will see they are there almost all over the world. The darker the color, the greater the frequency and the greater the intensity. You will see very dark colors in America, in South America, in Asia, in China, and in Russia, etc. But if you see, after the disaster has gone, what is the impact it has left behind? What is the suffering that is happening? Then you will suddenly see a lot of change in the bottom map. America, disaster has occurred, but there is practically no after effect. But if you see India and Africa and Latin America, disasters have gone, but they have also left behind a lot of impact. Which means the less developed a country, the poorer the people, the more their inability to cope with disasters. So, and therefore, the poorest people in the most underdeveloped parts of the world are the worst victims of disaster. That's why it has become internationally a very important kind of thing. Next one. Adir also over. Yeah, India, this is the same 2 to 12%, etc. This we have discussed. Next one. Hazards, exposure, vulnerability, this already I have explained to you. Next one. Now, this also shows the value of preparedness. Ab dekhiye ab, Richter scale, as you know, it is a exponential scale. 6.5 is not just one step above 6.4, but it's almost like 6.4 into 6.4. So, even 1 point means a lot of increase in the intensity. But if you roughly take 6.7 in USA, California, an earthquake killed 40 people. The same strength earthquake in Iran, in Bam, killed 40,000 people. So, you can just imagine the value of tayari, preparedness. You know, how much you can save by being ready for an event. Because the most important point I am trying to make is prevention and preparedness are much more important than rescue, relief, rehabilitation, recovery, etc. after the event. Next one. Then, this is in India, different zones, it's not very important. Next one. This, you see, I have spent a good part of my life in the last 10-15 years trying to persuade people, senior political leaders, senior civil servants in Delhi. Why? Actually, I think we can switch it off. Iski zarurat nahi hai.
Cell phone.
Oh, acha. Oh, aapka baj raha hai shayad. Main bismillah ke waqt hi bol diya. अच्छा नहीं वो बच गया कोई बात नहीं अच्छा then thank you ma'am अच्छा thank you very much then I met the then chief minister नाम अब बताने भी कोई हर्ज नहीं बच्चे दोस्त हैं हमारे अभी by God's grace he is alive and very active रोसाया साहब उस वक्त chief minister थे so in that year महबूब नगर और कर्नूल एक अब तेलंगाना में है आंध्रा में है वहाँ पर बाढ़ हुई थी एंड ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ दैट लॉट ऑफ डैमेज टू प्लेस पीपल डाइड एंड ऑल दैट एनडीआरएफ हैड टू कम एंड वर्क एंड ऑल दैट तो दैट इयर्स प्रोजेक्टेड ग्रोथ रेट ऑफ द स्टेट द प्रोजेक्टेड रेट ऑफ द ग्रॉस डेवलपमेंट प्रोडक्ट ऑफ द जीडीपी ऑफ आंध्र प्रदेश वॉज एग्जैक्टली इक्वल टू द डैमेज क्रिएटेड बाई दोज टू इवेंट्स इन टू डिस्ट्रिक्ट The entire developmental effort of the whole two states of today was neutralized by one event in two districts. So, but this was, I met Mr. Rosaya in 2011, after the 2009 event. Today we are in 2018. Till today, they have not even constituted the state disaster management authority, either in Telangana or in Andhra Pradesh. Aapko, all types of developmental thing, you will see Amaravati being built, you will see new secretariat being built, you will see thousands of crores being spent on Asian Games and things like that. Children are being sold in Hyderabad city, women are being not given the honor they deserve in parts of our country, farmers are committing suicide, disasters are happening, no money is spent on these things. And I am sorry to say, the situation is no different even in the government of India. So the two states and the country in which I live, you know, because wherever I go, bahut fakr hai mujhe, you know, Hindustani kehlane ka. I am very, very proud. Because, hum, kya nahi ki hum log, you know, a bloodless revolution, we got independence without shedding one drop of blood, ahimsa ke taur se. And then, Hyderabad city in particular, whether it is Hindu, Muslim, Jain, Buddhist, Farsis, etc. We celebrate Diwali, we celebrate the Eid, we celebrate, Christmas with the same, fervor. But here, our IITs, our IIMs, our UPSC, our Election Commission, our Supreme Court, all these things, whenever I go abroad, I put my collar up and say, look, I'm an Indian, I've got this, all these things. But when I look at these things, have you got a disaster management apparatus? Are you able to give drinking water to all your people? Are children living for the age of 2 without dying for want of medicines? I'm not able to say yes. So, disaster management is another area, as rightly pointed out earlier, is where, I think a lot more has to be done. Okay, next one. The hazard profile of India, not necessary. You will discuss it in the your workshop and all. Next one. Earlier, disaster management was being discussed, dealt with in the agriculture ministry. Then it was transferred to home ministry. For obvious reasons, because home ministry's voice is as much stronger. It can get people. If agriculture secretary, I am a secretary of agriculture in government of India. If I call for a meeting from other ministries, even a joint secretary will not come. But if a home secretary calls for a meeting, people, that is our tehzeeb. It cannot be helped. So it was shifted to home ministry. Next one. Finally, in 2005, what I was telling you, the paradigm shift from giving more importance to rescue, less importance to rescue, relief and rehabilitation, and concentrating on preparedness and prevention. This started in 2005, following the tsunami which happened in 2004. That was the wake-up call. Until then, the country used to wake up, put it, say, hit the snooze button, give a 10 minute ke baad dekhenge, go back to sleep. But finally, they did it at that time. But importantly, what happened in the Disaster Management Act was, the Act gives policy, guidelines, plans, finances, and everything put together in one place, not merely ki bhai kuch karenge and some sort of empty promise, but something which is tightly, you know, put together. Next one. This recently we had that cyclone Hudhud in Visakhapatnam. That was an excellent example of how preparedness can be important and how preparedness can be increased by simple methods. Our IMD was able to predict Hudhud cyclone 1 week in advance. 10 years ago, when I was in 15 years ago, when I was in NDMA, we used to get cyclone warnings only a couple of days before it. Kabhi kabhi we used to be told ki bhai kal ho jayega tufan. What will you do in one day? And that too, they used to say, anywhere between Chennai and Calcutta, in such a large area, with such little time, what can you do? In Visakhapatnam, 1 week ago, they said, this will happen in Visakhapatnam. So much time and so little area, everybody was able to get together. And it was a remarkable, you know, display of the value of preparedness. So this is an important thing. So, but this has to be improved in the future. Next one. You see, this is another important thing. First, kijiye some, you know, a child falls into a well and somebody goes and saves that child. Tomorrow morning, you'll see his paper and photo in the newspapers. Probably KCR will give him a medal or something. And then the whole city of Hyderabad will sing his praises and all that. But if somebody goes to somewhere near Nalgonda and does something in, the canals coming from Nagarjun Sagar and prevents flooding from taking place in Hyderabad, you'll never know who did what. So there is no glamour in prevention, whereas there is a lot of high visibility in rescue and relief and things like that. So that is one reason why even politicians, if you do Nagarjun Sagar, if you repair the reservoir and increase its capacity, nobody will notice anything. But if you build with the same money four new small reservoirs in Medak or in Krishna district, people will get votes because new areas will come under, this. So, maintenance, repairs, this prevention, preparedness, these are not either politically or in administratively attractive areas. That is why it is not still getting the recognition which is due. Next one. Ab dekhiye. Now, this is another example of the importance our country gives to preparedness, that in 1975, Government of India prepared a draft floodplain zoning resolution. Floods are a state subject, so they couldn't bring a law in parliament. That's a very complicated. You can legislate on a state subject, but very complicated. So they said, bhai, here is a draft law. Sent it to all the states, including states like Hyderabad and Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. Hyderabad, we know every year what happens when it rains. And Andhra Pradesh and Vijayawada and other places, there are so many floods. In Warangal, we have floods, etc. So they said, please enact it in your state. Till today, after 42 years, two states have enacted it. Can you guess which states? Rajasthan and Manipur. Rajasthan mein to pani ka naam hi nahi hai. And then Manipur is such a small state, they do have floods. And Hyderabad, West Bengal, Bihar, UP, no state has enacted this till today. So that shows the importance the subject is being, given even till today. We talk of so many, you know, so many leaders tell us on the TV channels in the evening I watch, so many loud, you know, tall claims are made about so many things. Hey, bhai, save lives and property every year, no? At least put the kanoon in place. Wo bhi nahi kar paaye hum log. This is the sad commentary on the current situation. Next one. Now, this is the paradigm shift I was talking about. National level, state level, district level, authorities have to be constituted. That they have not been constituted is a separate issue. The law mandates it. And then you have to make policy. I was, you know, involved in, I had the good fortune of being involved in the preparation of the national policy. And then there are guidelines on different subjects. And then states have to make plans, district have to make plans, funds have to be allocated for those plans. Whether it's happening or not, we shall see. Next one. NDMA, etc. Then there's a thing called National Executive Committee. All these we'll be discussing in the workshop. Next one. Next one. These are the different ministries in Government of India which deal with different disasters. Next one. Next one. The same thing is happening still. These I've told you just now, district level, state level and national level. Next one. This is the National Disaster Response Force. Now, our Registrar Sahab was mentioning that it's not a cohesive force there. I don't agree with him. It is true that it is constituted by drawing forces from different paramilitary forces. But it's an extremely tightly formed organization. It has done remarkable work. And you see, earlier, after independence, whenever a state intended for support from the central government, two or three things had to happen. One, the disaster had to take place first. Then the state had to try and fail. Then only it could approach the Government of India. Now it is not like that. The minute the warning comes, sometimes no warning is required. We all know August and September are the months during which floods take place in Andhra Pradesh or in Bihar. Where is the need for a warning? So NDRF goes to those potentially vulnerable areas and camps there in advance. So there is no need for anybody to call for it to come. And it does rehearsals with the local people and with other departments concerned. So there is coordination, it is familiar with the terrain, it understands the language, and people also understand what is to be done. Earlier, the Indian Army used to come from, one battalion from Chandigarh will be sent to Nagarkoil. They can't speak Tamil, they don't know the area. Already the disaster has taken place because until they were asked, they could not come. So all these things have changed in recent times, and NDRF is doing very good work. Next one. These are, you know, between the National Crisis Management Committee and NDMA, some division of subjects. Next one. These are what NDMA has prepared guidelines upon. I mean, not merely on cyclones, floods, earthquakes, landslides, etc., but also on thematic issues like medical preparedness, psychosocial support, etc. Next one. Financial support is also built in the disaster management, as I told you. The planning commission, which deals with plan finance, and the finance commission, which deals with non-plan areas and devolution of funds to states, both have been, and then funds have been created also. The National Disaster Response Fund and the National Disaster Mitigation. Next one. Now, flexi funds are also available now with central ministries concerned, and also MPs have been allowed to give from their MP LAD scheme. And corporate social responsibility, the NDMA is coordinating with the private sector also to use their obligation under CSR towards disaster management. Next one. Next one, please. Yeah, next one. This is the vision of the national policy to build a safe and disaster resilient India. I'm sure you'll be coming across this in your workshop. Next one. Strategy, prevention, mitigation, I already told you about this. Next one. National policy, you will be discussing this, I am sure, in your workshop. Next one. Next one. This plan was released recently. It's one of the milestones that the country has witnessed in recent times. The Prime Minister released the National Disaster Management Plan, which is an important development. I am sure they will be going to the other ones very soon. Next one. These are the calamities about which guidelines have already been issued. There's no need to go through the list. Next one. Next one. Next one. You see, as it has been mentioned earlier, wherever some training is take place in the country and wherever some education is taking place, schools, colleges, IAS officers being trained, IPS officers being trained, railways, income tax, etc., NDMA is sending some person there so that this becomes a part of that training. And is also being put in the syllabus of the children and in colleges. We wanted actually that disaster management should be taught in medicine, in chartered accountants, to lawyers, in some ways, so that every citizen who is educated knows something about disaster management. It is still a work in progress. It's happening. Next one. In the Masuri, of course, naturally, and in the police academy, it's happening. Next one. This, an important thing, this shows it at one glance, the log frame of disaster management structure in our country. The act, the national policy, the guidelines, the plans, the structural and non-structural measures. As I told you, if you say in Hyderabad city, you say next to Musi River on the bank, you cannot build any house. And if you build anything even a little farther away, the following rules have to be observed in terms of material, in terms of design, etc. That's a non-structural measure because it's only a law. But if you actually build a dam and to stop water from entering, like Kosi Dam, which is on the border of Nepal and India, that's a structural measure. So two types of measures arise out of the plans, and then finances for those measures by from the Planning Commission and the Finance Commission. So actually following that, thanks to our, being able to persuade the Finance Commission, in the last Finance Commission, a lot of money was also given to local bodies. For instance, fire, I'll give you another example. The ability of the fire department in a country to deal with disasters is an important thing. Suppose 100 marks represents the best fire department in the world, say Singapore, I would give it say 98% or something. India will get 2%. Pehle toh, there is no petrol, or the force is not trained, there is no equipment, the number is very small. So, for that, we said this is the most important thing, no? The Finance Commission at that time gave some 525 crores in the country. It was just a beginning. And also, national reserves. Suppose we know that West Bengal is flood prone. Why should we wait for a flood to come for buying things like electric saws, matchboxes, food, etc.? Why not store it in that area so that later on the difficulty doesn't arise of carrying it there? So national reserves are also available along with the battalions of the NDRF. Next one. This is how disaster management is woven into plan development. This is already covered to some extent, and I'm sure you'll be discussing it in your workshop. Next one. Next one, next one. States, next one. This is what the states have done. I have already told you this. Next one. See, some states have done very well. For instance, Gujarat has prepared a vulnerability assessment report. Kerala has its own policy. Bihar has inducted some experts. All, as I told you, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana have done nothing else. But I am only trying to tell you that some beginning has happened here and there wherever the states have taken interest. Next one. Next one. Next one. The NIDM is sort of a support organization of the NDMA, which deals with education, training and all that. It's doing very well. No need to go into details now. Next one. Next one. The NDRF, I already told you. Next one. Next one. Yeah. This is where the battalions currently are and some more are planned. Next one. Next one. And these are the strengths of the NDRF. I'm sure you'll be discussing the details. Next one. This is a list of some of the activities with NDRF. You will see, for instance, in Cyclone Hudhud, they did a very good job. They did a good job in Nepal. They did a good job in Chennai in the floods recently, etc. Next one. They also went to Japan on their invitation and did an extraordinary job. Next one. These are some of the projects which are being run by NDMA, no need to go. What I will do, Professor Rahmatullah, is that I have a small 10-slide thing about how NDRF performed in Japan. I will not do it now, I will give it to you. You please, in one of the sessions, you can cover it. How the Japanese people's culture and how the NDRF, combined to, give a lot of relief at that time. Okay, next one. Next one. This school safety program, one of the programs run by NDMA. Next one. This is another open university in Delhi we did with them. Next one. These are some capacity building programs. No need. This list of all projects will be with you. Next one, you will find them on the... This I told you is an important thing. Every year, when we are approaching the disaster season, cyclone season we know in Andhra Pradesh or West Bengal, flood season we know in West Bengal or Orissa or UP. At that time, in those places, they go and do rehearsals and mock drills. NDRF goes there, NDMA members go there, and the district administration, so that everybody knows exactly what the state of preparedness is. And before the disaster strikes, what you should do. Next one. Now, this is the last one important thing I want to tell you. Dr. Manmohan Singh once asked us, how well is our country prepared? Now, we had no answer to that. I told you we are from different backgrounds, so all of us went back, spent a week, came back and prepared a list like this. Suppose 100 marks are to be given to preparedness. What is preparedness? All of us consensually agreed that these 12 factors constitute preparedness. Awareness generation, guidelines, fire department, education, then science and technology interventions, forecasting, IMD, etc. Different marks, because depending on the importance, 100 marks. Then next one. Then we told the Prime Minister, 2 years ago, when we all came here, India would have got 29 marks out of 100. Today, because of what we have done, even now, we will get only 47%. If you continue all these things for 5 more years, you will reach 72%, we told you. But that 5 years thing has not happened. But this is not a formal scientific thing. I will also give you 3 articles I have written in Hans India, arguing that we should have a disaster preparedness index for the world and that India should prepare a model. Okay, if that is done, then year after year, we can, calibrate this and see, like blood pressure, temperature and pulse for a human being. Every year, how were you last year, how are you this year, and whether you are proceeding in the right, at the rate or not. This is next one. These are some of the issues which require immediate attention, establishment of a fund, then a database, then funds for the plans of this to be prepared by the state, and then risk assessment, how it is to be done, etc. Then next one. This Japan thing, I said, I'll give it to you. Okay, so now in the end, what I wish to say is, you must have heard of Sadi's Gulistan. It is the fountain of wisdom for the Parsis. In that, at one point, Sadi says that he who speaks unnecessarily, when it is not required to be for him to speak, and he who does not get up and speak when it is necessary to speak, he is not an akalmand. So similarly, in India also, we have to do everything. We must play. We must win in cricket. We must do Mangalyaan, go to Venus. We must go to Arctic. We must do this thing. But first, what should we do immediately? Should we look after our children, our women, prevent people from dying in disasters, give drinking water, prevent farmers from committing suicides, see that nobody goes hungry? So, similarly, that I think wisdom lies in government organizing their priorities correctly. We have, as a country, from playing chess to going to Venus, there is nothing we have been unable to do. But that strength has to be harnessed in the proper way by our leaders, is what I wanted to say. And ultimately, I like this very much, what Mr. Vajpayee once said. He said, Ucha mastak ubhra seena, jina ho to aisa jina. That is the way an Indian should feel, and that you can never feel if you are unable to prevent children and women from dying and then not being able to give water and food and things like that. And lastly, I think I've overshot my time. There's a beautiful sentence somebody told me once. He said, I'm sorry I wrote such a long letter to you because I didn't have time to write a short letter. Because it takes much more preparation to make something brief. So I couldn't shorten it in time. But one last thing I wish to tell the planners and the politicians and the civil servants and academicians and corporate sector leaders, chartered accountants, lawyers, everybody in this country, that there is a gentleman called Rajnikant Rao who lives in Vijayawada. He is 103 years old. I went for his birthday two years ago. He joined All India Radio when it was called by that name in 1937. So he writes poems, he writes, he plays, he acts, he sings, he's a multicolored personality. One poem, one stanza which he wrote, I remember, those who have studied physics will understand this. The universe is expanding, and at the edge of the universe, today, 13.7 billion years away from where the center, there are ripples of energy. So energy, whether it is sound or light or electromagnetism or heat, it's interconvertible. So this man's stanza says, Omkara Parivrittam Viswam. That means Omkara is just the one method of saying that energy is what abounds in the universe. Omkara Parivrittam means circumscribed. So at the edge of the universe, there are ripples of energy. Parivrittam Viswam. Sankalpa Parivitam Drishyam. That means if a wise man shuts his eye, the vision he sees is as big as he wants it to be. So our people must learn to think big is my submission. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for giving us a very enlightening address on disaster management in India and highlighting what has to be done and what are the challenges way ahead and how do we look at how the preparation and prevention and control needs to be focused upon. And now we have a small ceremony, that is, I would say, a presentation of books to our chief guest and our president of the function. So I now call upon Farheen. No, presentation of book, mementos and books. I now request Farheen.
I also wish to tell the audience that I can. I'm a great aficionado of Urdu. I've learned to write, I've learned to speak, I've learned to read, and from Mr. Sudhakala,
I've learned to speak. Excellent, sir. Really appreciate it.
Coming to this university today has been one of the most happiest moments in my life.
Sir, I now request Farheen. And now, to Professor V.S. Prasad, Farheen again, could you kindly? We have books instead of mementos, sir. And now, the other part of the program is, we release our souvenir. Release of the souvenir, please. Dr. Najeeullah, could you please help us? Souvenir is in
Thank you.
And we also have a book release function of Dr. Abdul Khayyum Sahab, Associate Professor, Department of Public Administration, MANUU. And he has to his credit almost 23 books written in Urdu. And I now request Professor V.S. Prasad to release the books written by Dr. Abdul Khayyum. Request Professor V.S. Prasad Sahab to deliver the presidential address. And before that, I would like to give a brief bio sketch of Prasad Sahab here. Professor V.S. Prasad was born in the village Mahadevapuram in Khammam district of Telangana, India. He obtained his master's and PhD in public administration from Usmania University, Hyderabad. Professor V.S. Prasad is known for his contribution to open and distance learning and quality assurance. During his more than four decades of academic life, held many academic and educational leadership positions, which include professor of public administration, pro vice chancellor, and acting vice chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Open University, vice chancellor of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University, and director of National Assessment and Accreditation Council. Professor Prasad is an internationally recognized expert in the field of open and distance learning. The Commonwealth of Learning, in recognition of his services to ODL, honored him with the award of Fellowship of Commonwealth of Learning. Professor Prasad headed the project of Government of Mauritius as Project Director, Open University of Mauritius from January 2009 to 2010 for the establishment of Open University in Mauritius. Professor Prasad, as a Quality Assurance Professional, headed India's premier quality assurance agency, that is National Assessment and Accreditation Council, NAAC, as director from 2003 to 2008, and also actively associated with the activities of international quality assurance agencies. Presently, Professor Prasad is engaged in the study and advocacy activities in higher education, particularly in areas of open and distance learning and quality.
Dr. Kaneja, the convener of the program, very distinguished participants, colleagues from the university, ladies and gentlemen. I am thankful to the university for this opportunity. I am more thankful to Professor Rahmatullah, who asked me to preside over the function, the most easiest job. See, so I am thankful to him for this opportunity. I had the privilege of associating with this university since the days of first Vice Chancellor, Professor Shamim Jairajpuri, in different capacities. I am very happy today to participate in today's program. The university is very active in different areas. The campus is very vibrant with many activities. And I would like to congratulate the university for these initiatives and the programs. I also would like to congratulate the Department of Public Administration, which is organizing this program, for two things. One is for selecting the very appropriate topic. Second is equally important is identifying the appropriate person to give the keynote address. This is also equally important. Professor Mohan Kanda, Dr. Mohan Kanda has a very rich experience in this field. Not only rich experience, he has a rich capacity of articulating his experience also. This is also very, very important. I really enjoyed listening to him when he rightly focused on sustainable development is possible only when disaster mitigation is integrated in the development process. Unless it is integrated, the development cannot be a sustainable development. And he also rightly focused on the need for policies and plans from a national level to the district level, at different levels, state level and different levels. He also rightly emphasized the importance of preparedness. Even though it is a non-glamorous activity, the importance of preparedness and mitigation, more than the relief and rehabilitation activity. And he suggested the disaster preparedness index. These are very, really important. So I am very much thankful to him for an opportunity to listen to him. Secondly, the department also I would like to congratulate it because, see, in the social sciences, we have a question of relevance of social sciences in today's education contest. This approach of social sciences in organizing this seminar, I look at it as an approach of what is called as a engaged social science approach. That means you are engaged in understanding and addressing the social problems. That is the engaged social science approach. I think that approach makes social sciences relevant to the society. Social science education relevant to the society. The knowledge which you generate by engaging in socially relevant issues. This is a disaster management is an important socially relevant issue. And engaged social science approach focuses on critically engaging in understanding the issue and generating the knowledge which can be an input for policy making and input for actions. That is the, I think, is an important. This is also based on a philosophical approach of what is called as a public value of social sciences. What is the public value of social sciences? When you are looking at the social sciences, what is the public value of social sciences? A social scientist, John Brewer, identified three dimensions of public value of social sciences. What is he calls them as the use value, second is an exchange value, and third is normative value. The normative value of social sciences is very, very important. To quote him, I would like to quote him what he means by the normative value. The normative value of social sciences, he refers to, it nurtures a moral sentiment in which we produce and reproduce the social nature of society, enables us to recognize each other, so social beings with a shared responsibility for the future of humankind through understanding, analyzing, and addressing fundamental social problems. This is the normative approach of social sciences. I think that normative approach of social sciences makes the social sciences very relevant, and the department has taken this initiative. I would like to congratulate the department for this initiative. I am asked to be the guest of honor and make some observations. You see, I also identified few observations, you see, which I can make it. I thought that in my presidential address, I would like to make these few observations. You see, when we are discussing about this, I know that when we are talking about the disaster management, it is a multidisciplinary activity and where the scientists are involved, where the administration is involved, health professionals are involved, and the whole society is involved. It is not a public administration activity or a political science activity or any particular area of studies. It is a multifunctional activity and multidisciplinary activity. But as students of administration, in what way we are able to make some contribution to the whole question of disaster management? To me, our focus should be on, you see, as the students of administration, our focus is on the study of institutions. Institutions as the rules, regulations, behavior, values, and organizations created to achieve the objectives. So our study is focuses on the institutions. When we are trying to study institutions related to the disaster management, to me, two questions are very, very important. Two questions are, what type of socio-political context is conducive to make the institutions effective to realize the objectives? Suppose you have many institutions created for addressing the question of disaster management. What type of a socio-political context is required? Dr. Kanda is referring to he made a comparison between the Japanese and Indian contests also. See, when we are looking at what type of a context is required, that is one question we had addressed. Second question is, what type of internal processes are desirable to make the institutions effective? In the Sustainable Development Goals developed by the UN 2015, in 15 years target Sustainable Development Goals, 17 goals they have developed. Goal number 16 talks about the justice, peace and other things, also talks about effective institutions and accountable institutions are necessary to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. So my second question is, what type of institutional processes are desirable, are necessary to make the institutions achieve their objectives? This is how the students of administration can make a contribution to the study of a disaster management by studying the institutional context and institutional processes. I think these are the two important aspects. When Dr. Kaniza invited me on that day on telephone, immediately my mind went to the two books. One is the questions of the contest. In the question of the contest, Amartya Sen wrote a book on poverty and famines. And his whole argument is in that book, you see, the whole argument is, you see, in the democratic polity, famines do not occur. He made a study of famine in 1943, that is the Bengal famine. He also later made a study of famine in China, 1958 and 60 famine in China. He says after 1947 in India, has not faced any major famine because of a democratic polity. China faced a major famine problem which the world doesn't know. Only later the world came to know because of the particular political system. So the point he is arguing, and which is very relevant for disaster management also, what type of a political system, what type of a social system can help the disaster management activities to be effective? This is what we are looking at. So the democracy is an essential requirement. The ills of democracy can be cured by more democracy only, but democracy, democratic polity, democratic system is very necessary. Dr. Kanda rightly pointed out, poor are more affected by the disasters. Poor are more affected. If the poor are more affected, only in a democracy can respond to the needs of the poor. You see, that is the democracy's the strength, can respond to the needs of the poor. And the people can rise. Suppose, you see, there is also a reference to Rahmatullah referred to the 1980 Bhopal gas tragedy. If you look at the Bhopal gas tragedy, industrial disasters, if you see the throughout the world, industrial disasters, why these industrial disasters are occurring? And particularly in the developing countries, they are occurring more than the developed countries. It also has something to do with the global power structure. The developing countries are used as a guinea pigs by the global world. So the industrial problems or the industrial disasters are a result of this global power structure. So to understand the disaster management causes or problems or types, industrial disasters, if you have to understand the problems of environmental protection, we have to understand the global power structure, we have to understand the national power structure, how the institutions are operating in this particular context, and how the systems are being used by the people, which are resulting in man-made disasters more. Even nature-made disasters are a result of a environmental degradation. So the first point I am making is, if you want to understand the role of the institution, try to understand the role of the institution in the context of its
polity in the context of its social structures. So this is the first point. So that's why the democratic polity and democratic context is very, very important, and Amartya Sen works is very, very important. The second observation, see, about when we are looking at the effectiveness of the institutions, the internal processes we are looking. See, the Mohan Kanda gave a very detailed description of all the structures and systems. My own feeling is as a student of administration, there is a wide gap between the ideal or between the normative frame and actual practice. In, I think it is in 2000, it is, I think in 2000, Sainath, Palagumi Sainath, a well-known journalist who got Magsay Award also, wrote a book. The title of the book is Everybody Loves a Good Drought. Why everybody loves a good drought? Later, I think John Joseph, another journalist, wrote a book on Feast of Vultures. The democratic processes are resulting as a feast of vultures. The Sainath's focus, it is actually the study of poverty, poverty study, and the study of rural poverty, particularly many districts he has studied. More than 100 universities, this book is referred as a reference book in the study of rural development and poverty studies. See, the strength of that is, he says that how the drought is being used by different people as a sort of an opportunity to make more money or to use the public resources, misgovernance of activities. So if there is a disaster, there is vultures, not literally, even metaphorically also, the people use this as an opportunity to make more money. That's why in the whole context of institutional operations, why these things are happening? It is said that somebody said that this is okay, if there is a disaster, there are some people who are unhappy, who are suffering, and there are some people who are very happy also. Very happy also. This is the contradiction in which we are living. So the institutional context, to understand the institutional context, our problem is, you see, as a student of administration, I always find, sir, as a student of administration, institutional studies in public administration do not have a sufficient breadth of the method and approaches to make these studies relevant. When we are studying these things, the breadth of methodology, the broad scope, that is very, very important. Probably we have to overcome, or we have to come out from neutral efficiency model of Weber and look for some other models of institutional functioning and some other dimensions of institutional functioning to understand the effectiveness of the institutions to address the questions of disaster management. Ultimately, the institutions have to address the questions of disaster management. That's why the students of social sciences or students of public administration, maybe probably you have to learn something from Gandhi's moral approach, maybe something from Marx's class approach, maybe something from Ambedkar's social justice approach, to understand the dimensions of institutions and their working, how these institutions can address the problems of disaster management. Ultimately, the society's capacity to create these institutions, how the society can create these institutions, and how the society can make them as an effective institutions. That's why Dr. Kanda rightly emphasized the point of, you see, many institutions were there. And that's why he also rightly emphasized the sort of problem of preparedness is not being given enough importance, and the institutions also are looking for some other things, you see, that type of things. I think the effectiveness of the institutions also is very, very important. I think these are the two aspects I thought that I can bring to your attention, and you can reflect on these things also. Lastly, one observation to the, I thought that Vaisans also will be here. Vaisans is not there, but the director can communicate this to the authorities of the university also. When we are looking in the educational programs also, there is a reference to the IGNO activities and school activities, all those things also. The universities, educational activities, you see the preparing the universities with the knowledge and all those things. More than that, if you look at it as merely, not merely as only a service activity, in the extension activities also many institutions are participating. But you look at it as a learning activity also. Make it as a learning activity also. Then integrate it in your learning processes. Suppose if you attend 20 classes, if you attend 80 classes is required, required for a program, suppose a course, you have to attend 80 classes or you have to attend 60 classes. In the course, if you can also integrate attending to the addressing the mitigation problems or addressing the disaster management problems, if some staff member spends 10 days or if some student spends 10 days, give some credits for that learning credits for them. It is an incentive. Try to actively involve them in that learning process also. I think this also is a university's contribution. I am very happy to participate in this today's program. I am thankful to the organizers for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Up the responsibility and how the mitigation process, prevention and control should go a long way. I mean, with a coordinated effort is what sir referred to as in his presidential address. I now call upon my colleague Dr. Sayed Najiullah for giving the vote of thanks.
Respected Chairperson and the August gathering, good afternoon and assalamu alaikum. It gives me immense pleasure to propose the vote of thanks in this 2-day 4th National Seminar on Disaster Management. Indeed, it's a great pleasure for the Department of Public Administration to have such dignitaries in this inaugural function. I am very thankful to you, Dr. Mohan Kanda sir. You have brought a vast experience to this 2-day seminar on disaster management. You as a chief secretary and also chairman of the disaster management, there is no other person appropriate for the inaugural function than you, and your speech has enlightened us and also set the right kind of agenda for this 2 days national seminar. I thank you, sir, on behalf of the Department of Public Administration for accepting our invitation and also enlightening us and also bringing your vast experience to this forum. And I'm very much thankful on behalf of the University, Maulana National University, also for making a visit to this university. And I hope that you will continue your association and support to this university in future as well. I also thank Professor V.S. Prasad, who has a pioneering person in the field of public administration, who has been a vice chancellor of Ambedkar Open University, director of NAAC. He has been directing and monitoring university systems. Sir, your vast experience and your presence in this 2-day seminar inaugural function itself indicates the kind of a success of this. I think it's a kind of assurance of the success of this seminar. I'm very much thankful to you on behalf of the Department of Public Administration and also Maulana National Urdu University. You have been associated with us in different capacities with DDE, and also I hope that you will continue your support in the future days also. I thank you, sir, on behalf of the university and also on behalf of the audience for your presidential remarks, in which you also made that how institutions, particularly administrative system and political systems, are also very much relevant for the disaster management, and how these two things can go. And it has given really insights to us how we can frame our curriculum and relate and also engage with the more actively with the disaster management. Thank you for your guidance, sir. I also thank the registrar of the university, Maulana National University, Dr. M.A. Sikandar sir, for accepting our invitation at the last moment and also gracing the occasion as a guest of honor and also giving his address. We also value his words and all that, even though he's busy. I thank the registrar on behalf of the Department of Public Administration, not only for gracing the occasion, but all his support for this 2-day seminar, even in identifying the resource persons. They have been very supportful. And I also thank the Pro Vice Chancellor, Professor Shakil Ahmed Saab, who has been a very guiding force, and also he has also helped us in identifying and the speakers and providing all the support. I also thank the Vice Chancellor of the University, Professor Dr. Muhammad Aslam Parvez Sahab, for guiding us and also providing a platform, supporting on each step to go ahead with this seminar and also for his constant support for the Department of Public Administration. I also thank Dean of School of Social Sciences for supporting, for being a constant support, and also our dignitaries who has come from different departments, deans, heads, and professors, and faculty, and also the delegates who have come from faraway places like Delhi, Aligarh, and Kerala, so and other places, different places, to participate in this two-day workshop. I thank you very much for your patience, participation in the inaugural session. I also thank the library librarian sir for providing this auditorium, and also the IMC team for covering, and the media persons, and also the non-teaching staff, supporting staff of the department, and the my colleagues who have been making a lot of efforts for the smooth functioning, and also the students of the department and students from different departments of the university. I also take this opportunity to thank the director of the seminar, Professor S.M. Rahmatullah, who has been a guiding force and who has been helping us in conducting this seminar. And also I thank the department on my behalf, the department, the HOD of the department, Dr. Kani Zehra, for conducting this seminar. And on behalf of the Department of Public Administration, I thank each and everyone who has been part and parcel of this seminar, who has been supporting. I thank you very much. There are two announcements. One is that for the delegates, please submit your full papers in the registration counter, so that to prepare your certificates and all that. All the delegates who are presenting paper. Second announcement is the tea is there. We will have a tea break for 10 minutes. Initially it was supposed to be 15 minutes because we are supposed to break at 11:45, but it is already 12:30. So we will break for 10 minutes and we will reassemble here after 10 minutes.